Will the congregation please rise in respect to the family of Charlie Luck? May be seated. In his paraphrase of the Bible that he wrote for his grandchildren, Eugene Peterson captures these words from the psalmist David. God, my shepherd, I don't need a thing. You have bedded me down in lush meadows. You find me quiet pools to drink from. True to your word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley, I'm not afraid when you walk by my side. Your trusty shepherd's crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a six-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessing. Your beauty and your love chase after me every day of my life. And now I'm back home in the house of God for eternity. We're gathered here this morning to mourn the death, but more importantly, celebrate the life of Charlie Luck. On behalf of Judy and Chris and Lynn and the rest of Charlie's family, I want to thank each of you for being with us today. Your presence is a gift of comfort and care to each member of his family, and the love that you share by being here provides them strength and solace in what is a very difficult time as they say goodbye to this very special man. Thank you for coming. Pray a word with me. Father, I bow in your presence today, so thankful that you are the God of all mercy and comfort, that you have come to meet with us this day and to bring the comfort that can come only from your hand to each of us, Lord, as we say goodbye to that which is physical of Charlie Luck. God, I thank you for the life that he's lived and for the way, God, that he lived that life, always making memories, always leaving a legacy that taught us lessons that are the most important lessons of life, faith and goodness and godliness. Father, I pray today that as we celebrate his life, you would help each one of us to remember him, but more importantly, to be changed by those memories, to be people who emulate his example, to have a tender heart and a tender faith that says, Jesus is my Lord. Be with Judy and with Chris and with Lynn today and the rest of the family. And may they know, God, your peace, your presence, then passes all understanding. And may they rest today knowing that, God, you will carry them through. In Jesus' name, amen. Charlie was a consummate fan of old country music. So that's what you're going to hear this morning. Pastor John.
Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise like a blind man, I wandered a long way.
praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Straight is the gate and narrow's the way. Now I have traded the wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
The psalmist asked this question in the 121st Psalm and then gave an incredible response. He said, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Behold, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He'll watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going from this time forth and forever. In the Lord, the psalmist found everything that he needed to navigate the many different passages of life. He made it clear that whether day or night, difficult or easy, good or bad, he had this constant assurance that the Lord would watch over him. This morning, Judy, that's good news. That in the days of this transition and change for you, God is with you. And the promise of his word is that he will not fail you nor forsake you. Solomon wrote that to everything there is a season. These seasons of life are often filled with incredible joy, but there are also those seasons that are filled with sadness. When we lose someone we love, we come to realize how deep the pain of grief really feels. But in those times, I want you to remember these words from the Bible, promises that God gives to us. When I'm afraid, I will put my trust in you. In God, whose word I praise, in God I've put my trust and I will not be afraid. His promise is to keep each one of you safe in his arms, holding you tight. The prophet Isaiah shared these words from the Lord when the Lord said, do not fear, for I'm with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you, surely I will help you, surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. When the pain and the uncertainty and the questions that come with death well up inside, remember these words. I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And in him, you will find strength and peace and the grace to continue on the journey. One of my favorite verses is a verse that just seems to fit times like these when we're not real sure what to do. The psalmist said in the 46th Psalm in the first verse, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Always remember that in your times of grieving, that because Charlie loved the Lord Jesus Christ and had a personal relationship with him. We are not a people who grieve as if we have no hope. Because today we know that Charlie is with the Lord. Last week he told Pastor John, and he told me as well, that he was just ready to be with Jesus. In fact, when I prayed with him on Saturday night, getting ready to pray with him on Saturday night, it was kind of an interesting experience. I said, Charlie, I want to pray with you. And we talked for a minute, and I said, okay, can I pray now? And he goes, yes. And I said, okay. And I took his hand, and I got maybe two words in, and he was snoring. And I thought, you know, it's kind of fitting. I put him to sleep when I preach. I put him to sleep when I pray. And then Pastor John says, well, he didn't sleep when I prayed. And, you know, but it was interesting. As I talked to Charlie, he said, could you just ask Jesus to take me? I'm so ready. What a testimony. And Judy, that's your hope. Because he is with the Lord, you have the promise that one day you will see him again because you share his faith and that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. May each one of us today look to the Christ who gives us hope and opening our hearts to him, receive the life and the love that he longs to give.
Tell me about the good old days. Sometimes it feels like this world's gone crazy. Grandpa, take me back to yesterday when the line between right and wrong didn't seem so. Lovers really fall in love to stay, stand beside each other, come what may. Promise really something people kept, not just something they would say. Families really bow their heads to pray, daddies really never. Families really bow their heads to pray.
Charles Wayne Charlie Luck was born on December the 14th, 1936 in Solomon, Kansas, the son of Charles James and Ethel Rouse McCain Luck. He died very peacefully this past Sunday afternoon, the 24th of November, at the Salina Regional Medical Center. Charlie was 82 years old. Having served in the United States Navy, Charlie followed his naval service by working at Beach Aircraft, where he was an electrician and electrical inspector. He also worked for Sellers Tractor, Greyhound Bus, and finally at Gibson's Ace Hardware, which was his favorite job of all. There's a story there. He started working there, I think, after his marriage, and I think he stayed there and worked there because he wanted to be close to his wife. He just couldn't stand to be away from her. Charlie is survived today by his wife, Judy McClure Luck, daughter Lynn Blount, and son Chris Luck, both of Salina. He's also survived by one sister, Barbara Hill of Dwight, Kansas. Charlie loved his grandchildren, and today he's survived by grandchildren Travis, Daniel, and Allegra, as well as his great-grandchildren, Kashana, Melissa, Keegan, Sadie, Landon, and Benna. Charlie was preceded in death by his parents, one brother, Preston Luck, and sisters Madge Kramer, Evelyn O'Shea, and Viola McIntosh. When I think about Charlie Luck this morning, I think about a very special man. A man of proud German heritage, he would often come up to me and greet me in German. I know no German, maybe Gesundheit. That'd be as close as I get. But I do know enough French to be dangerous, and so I would respond in French. And he'd kind of look at me with his head cocked, and he'd say, "I don't know what you said." And I'd say, "I don't know what you said." And we would both just decide to laugh and forget about it. But it never stopped him to keep coming up and doing it just to give me grief. And that was just the way Charlie was. He loved to have fun, often at your expense, but he loved to have fun. Known as the Candy Man, Charlie always had a pocket full of root beer barrels. That was just his trademark. And whether you were here on Sunday morning or with the grandkids or wherever he was, he always was passing out root beer barrels. And there was kind of this little thing. My grandson Landon learned what pocket he kept them in. And Landon would sneak in and sneak up alongside and reach into his pocket, and Charlie'd grab his hand and he'd let him have one. And on the Sundays that he didn't see Landon, Charlie would say, "Pastor John, let me give you a present. One for you and one for Landon." The problem was he would go up to Landon before church and he would say, "Did your papa give you your root beer barrel?" And it kept me honest. But since Landon is not here today, they're mine. Charlie was a good man, a dedicated father, who did the very best that he could when his kids were growing up. He never missed a time of visitation, and he would pick up Chris and Lynn, and they would make games out of the simplest things. Funny sounds going over rain tracks, railroad tracks, and funny sounds going under overpasses. He made certain that his children knew that he loved them. In his room, he had a picture, and I love this part of his story. Had a picture of his two children that was almost completely worn through the paper, because every night, the last thing he would do before he laid his head down was go and kiss his kids goodnight and tell them how much he loved them. Chris and Lynn, you were incredibly loved and incredibly special to your dad. But Judy, you were blessed for 31 years to be married to this man. From those days at Gibson's when he would come and buy things just to come through your line. I don't know how often he needed what he bought, but he always bought stuff just to come through your line. He had kind of taken a shine to you. Not sure how the kids would feel. One day, the story goes that he took Lynn with him and said, "Now I want you to kind of hang back a little, and I'm going to go up and talk to her, and when you see who she is, if you think that I ought to ask her on a date, I just want you to give me a sign." And so he's there talking to Judy, and he looks back, and Lynn's going, and so he did it. Now, bear in mind, they absolutely had no clue who each other was. except he thought she was really cute and wanted to go on a date. She finally relented and said, I'll meet you for coffee after work. And they met for a lot of coffees after work. And then one day he popped the question. Lynn said it was pretty soon after that. And she said, all of a sudden, Dad calls and says, I'm getting married. And the plans were set for Thanksgiving time 31 years ago. It was kind of interesting as the family began to show up at the church. Pastor Kolaw, my predecessor, began to ask questions. Why are you here? And they said, well, we're here for Charlie and Judy's wedding. And his brain quickly clicked on, and he had to run home and get his suit on to do a wedding. He'd totally forgot. But in spite of the fact that that happened, you enjoyed a beautiful wedding and marriage together. You were the apple of his eye, the love of his heart. And he treasured you, Judy, dearly. Charlie was known to many as Mr. Tinker. His little workshop was a place where miracles happened on a regular basis. There are many lawnmowers and many weed eaters that found second life in that workshop. I had one until just about 3 years ago that lived 10 years longer than it should have, because Charlie found a way to fix it. Even when I thought it was broken. He loved doing those things. And the more you could take to him, the better that he felt. Around here, Charlie was a special friend to all. He loved sitting in the West Foyer on Sunday mornings, eating a donut, drinking coffee, talking to everybody who came in. If you were special, you got a root beer barrel. If you weren't, I'm sorry. He loved people, and he loved to give them a hard time. Especially his pastor. And I could probably write a book about some of the things that we shared in our journey together. Charlie enjoyed reading and watching Westerns on TV, and he also loved football and basketball. He had this habit of writing down all the names of all the players and keeping track of all the information because he just wanted to know what was happening all the time. And it really came in handy because Judy loves to do crossword puzzles. And whenever she would get stuck with a sports trivia one, she'd just look at Charlie and say, it's this many letters and it has this letter in it. And he would just spout off the answer and fill it in. Judy, I don't know who will replace him. You may have lots of blanks moving forward. He just loved doing things with her. Charlie was a man of many talents. Lynn said her and Chris always loved it when they'd say, Dad, get on your head, you're going to drink some water. And he'd stand on his head and they'd give him a glass of water with a straw and make him drink it. Yes, we're fearfully and wonderfully made, and water does flow upstream somehow. Now, I can't really imagine this part of Charlie, but can you imagine Charlie's small frame squatting down and doing that Russian dance where you just kick your legs out? He would do it for like 10 minutes at a time. I'd do it for about 10 seconds and die. But he absolutely loved to do things like that, to make memories with his children and grandchildren. There are lots of things we could say today about Charlie Luck, but all of them pale in comparison to one thing, and that is that he was a passionate follower of Jesus Christ. A member of this church, he loved God with all of his heart. And he lived his life in such a manner that every family member and every friend knew that he had made a decision to follow Jesus. His greatest desire was that all of us would know Christ as our Savior, and that was especially true for his family. And I want to take a moment just to say to his grandchildren and his great-grandchildren that last week there was a moment when I was with him when he said, "Will you please do what I've been doing for a long time and just keep praying for my grandkids, that they will know the best of God." And I share that with you today because you were his heart. Charlie was a man of faith. And as we remember him this morning, that one verse from Revelation seems most important. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, their deeds do follow after them. Charlie leaves a legacy. And that legacy of faithfulness and that legacy of love and grace and tender mercy that he extended to everybody is something we all need to hold on to. But more than holding on to, it's something we need to embrace and allow that legacy to become our lives as we remember this special man. May God add his blessings as we remember Charlie this morning.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed, through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have
So I met with Judy and Lynn yesterday planning the service. We came to the point where we talked about this part in the service, where I would share a verse that meant something very special to them and out of it draw a word of comfort or help for each one of us here this morning. What they came up with really is a faith challenge, and it really describes the legacy that Charlie left for each one of us. It's found in John 14:6. Well, we read these words, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Those are interesting words in that they come in response to the Apostle Thomas's question where he said, Lord, we don't know where you're going. And Jesus very quickly retorted and said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He was trying to communicate to Thomas that if Thomas could just put his faith and his trust in him, he wouldn't have to worry about the future. It would be secure and certain. And that really is something that Charlie lived and understood very, very well. Charlie knew that Jesus Christ was the way to heaven. He understood that in a world where there are lots of folks who say there are lots of different paths to come into a relationship with God, he knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that that could only be achieved through one person, and that was Jesus. And Charlie sought him. He followed after him. He allowed him to lead. And whether times were good or times were bad, he was just certain that Jesus was the only way for life to make sense, for the journey to produce fulfillment, for joy to be found. And this morning, I think if Charlie could push me to the side and sit down here on this stool and begin to talk, he would probably say to each and every one of us, but especially to his family, never forget that Jesus is the only way. Charlie also knew that Jesus was the truth. Jesus embodied everything that God was and is to each and every one of us in this world, and he will always be that. Charlie knew that to know the truth, we had to know Jesus. And when we knew Jesus, we would know everything that we needed to know about God the Father. Where so much confusion abounds in our world today about everything from right and wrong to good and evil, where people seldom know how to treat one another with love and decency and kindness and respect, all of those things that were so important, Charlie said, there is a truth that sets the record straight. In fact, the other night when he and I were talking, he said to me he was ready to meet Jesus because he knew what Jesus had said to him was true. He loved him, he forgave him, and he held out for him the promise of heaven. That's something that all of us need to remember. That wherever you find yourself in life today, if your heart is not seeking after the truth as it's found only in Jesus, the way that you're taking will lead you to error, to falsehood, to brokenness. But if Jesus is the way and Jesus is the truth, where you wind up in the end will be a place of blessing indeed. Charlie also knew that when Jesus said, I am the life, he knew exactly what that meant. Jesus was not only the life here on earth, but he was also the life in heaven. And what he was on earth and what he became in heaven is what he extends to each one of us. Life here on this earth with the promise of eternal life in heaven. Charlie found joy and peace in everyday life and living because Jesus had given him just that, new life that was filled with joy and peace. That life was a life that knew forgiveness and had peace with God. That life was a life that gave him the assurance that when his time came, he would be welcomed into heaven. I really wish you could have been with us this last Sunday afternoon. Charlie crossed the bar, stepped into the arms of Jesus. Judy was sitting on the side of his bed on his left-hand side, and he just kind of turned his head that direction and snuggled into a pillow and went to sleep. The most peaceful of passings, the most peaceful of deaths. Because the life that he left here became eternal life in an instant as he stepped into the arms of Jesus. Absent from his body, he became present with the Lord. And this morning, that life is offered to each one of us, just as it was to Charlie. And this morning, if I could communicate anything on his behalf, it would be this. Don't spend one more moment of your life without allowing Jesus to be your way and your truth and your life. He died for each of us to have a personal relationship with him. And he's waiting for each of us right now to open our hearts to him and to receive the love and the grace that he longs to give. You might think it's a pretty hard thing to measure up to God's standards, and that's the beautiful thing. He takes us where we are, and he loves us, warts and all, and says, I'll forgive you and give you life. And this morning, if you would have to admit and say that, you know, I'm not living there, I want you to know I'd be available after the service, as would Pastor John, who's up in the sound booth, just to help you give your heart to Jesus today, because that was the most important thing to Charlie in the end, that we would all follow Jesus. Judy, today you know that your Charlie is with the Lord. Lynn and Chris, today you know that your daddy is in heaven. He's heard his final summons. Those words of incredible welcome. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. And so ours today is to say, Charlie, we will embrace your legacy of faith and choose like you to follow Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. For we know that our hope will be found only in him. Judy, because of Charlie's faith and the assurance that he is with the Lord forever today, Psalm 30, verse 5 seems to be a perfect way to draw this service to a close. Weeping endures for the night, but joy comes in the morning. The joy that is ours when we're welcomed into the Savior's embrace. Pray a word with me. Father, thank you today for Charlie Luck. For his love. For his way of putting a smile on everybody's face. For his way of making this pastor feel like he was far better than he was. Thank you, Lord, for Charlie Luck. Comfort us today with the assurance that because of his faith profession in Jesus Christ, we can know for certain today that he's with you. And help us to accept his invitation that in like manner we could choose to follow you. That one day we could renew an old acquaintance and enjoy heaven's shores with him. Father, if there's one here this morning who needs to open their heart to you, would you help them now simply to confess that they need you, to ask the forgiveness of their sins, and to open their hearts and say, Lord Jesus, I want you to come into me. And God, we know that if they'll do that, that's exactly what'll happen. And Charlie's legacy will be passed on. Bless his family, his friends, and most of all his memory, that as we remember his life, we can also focus on his Savior and say, thank you, Jesus, for caring for this special man. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Judy, it's my privilege today, on behalf of the President of the United States, the United States Navy, and a grateful nation, to present this flag to you in appreciation for Charlie's faithful and stalwart service as a member of the United States Navy. May you always be blessed as you look at this flag and remember the life that you shared together. This draws to a close our service here this morning. In just a moment, I'm going to pray a blessing over lunch, and if you'd like to stay, you're welcome to do that. We'd love to have you stay with us, an opportunity to greet the family there. Pray a word with me, and then I will dismiss the family, and they'll follow me out, and then the ushers will come and lead you out as well. Father God, I thank you today for this moment. And now as we transition, Lord, from a time of celebrating a memory to a time of sharing fellowship one with another, may we from each other experience love and peace. Bless now the food and those who've prepared it. May it be used for our good. In Jesus' name.